Let's talk about the replacement of the LibreOffice SVG for the favour of SVGIO, because just we met 2% of the textbooks that I said. So quantum is not so important, you can read it in the download, it's a presentation. So this talk describes the action taken to replace the existing LibreOffice SVG for the favour of SVGIO, mostly because we only want to have one, but let's go into details in a moment. So first, of course, I don't know how fast I will finish. Thanks to TDF and their donors for sponsoring that stuff. So I'm just to make sure I don't forget this at the end. So it's always important to have some financing around it. So why did this happen? There's an SVG import by change at all. So the state of the SVG imports already shown with the S since there was more than one. Before the change was there were just two different SVG imports. So they were used, one way used when opening an SVG as document directly, open document, and the other one when you already had a document open and inserted in SVG. So this were both triggering SVG imports but different ones. Both were handling different tasks in the sense of the user actions and using different methods to import, leading to different results, which is of course unexpected for the user. So problems are inconsistencies. The user does not understand why he does get different SVG qualities, because he normally is not aware that he is opening SVG as document or inserting it, so it's just one way and gets the same quality as before. And from the developer view, of course, the two importance to maintain is always a better idea. So just to show you what I'm talking about, I have prepared a 5.2 where it's not it, and a 6.2 where it's in. And to show you what's happening, I can just... Oh, mouse does not really work on this glass table. So for example, thank you very much. Yeah, thanks so much. Perfect. So when opening this document, you can just drop it and you see it's opening really as SVG document and in the 5.2 then you get SVG imported as single objects. You can just see that when you start to break them around. So the object is already no longer SVG, you now have a regular profile and SVG and original data is gone. And no way to go back and save it or something. So the other way around is when you use it wrong and just drop it. You see, it also gets imported, not too bad. And this time, it uses the SVGIO filter and stays a graphic object. It's a content of the graphic object is the original data. It's interpreted but not destroyed. So now, you are still able in the context menu to save the original SVG file. So that's the main difference. It's okay. So the two different techniques to import that stuff is once it's open as document import based on regular ODF importer, so it's not a bad idea what's the original idea. It just we're sitting above the regular ODF import, it guarantees that you can do everything in the document you need to do because of it's a regular mechanism to know the document. Just creates a DOM tree on the fly with ASCII, what is just needed, and puts it into the flow and works more or less like a new type. So, not too bad, but it was never too complete, and you have speed issues, and you run into problems of the consistency, and you get dependencies between the ODF importer and the SVG using it. So when someone changes ODF importer, maybe he kills SVG importer without knowing, and vice versa, you can run into problems. And the SVGIO, it uses a separated SVG DOM tree on demand, by the way, that creates a sequence of primitives. And this is important because for example, for SVG gradients, we can show them. We internally don't have SVG-like gradients in our model, not yet. But we can handle them, and we can decompose and draw them and shrink them and export PDF and everything. So the internal flow is more or less linearly there, but we have no UI or no stuff currently in our own file format to get some saved and loaded. So I was aware of it and thinking since a few years about how we could improve our gradients. We can already render them. So another advantage is it keeps the both original data, as you just have seen, you can save it again, and it's on-demand interpretation decomposition. More if you want to say a little bit later. So do we really need to import this? Of course not. So users don't understand the different stuff in work for developers and risk of influences already mentioned. How to get possible SVG turnaround is an interesting question. So to get that, we don't only need an importer but also an exporter, and that is an SVG exporter. We have one. So it's very interesting. You can select pages or one page in draw or inverse, and directly use the file export to export as SVG. And this even uses multi-page support, not only in Impress or even in Draw, it was very surprising when I saw that. And it's using the standard SVG 1.2 version. So this is not really officially existing, but I don't know who did it at the same time, this export, but it's more or less working, and it creates an SVG. You can open the browser and you can switch with the cursor keys through the pages. So it's somehow working. I don't know why. And it puts a lot of JavaScript into this export, which is managing all that stuff. So how to get rid of one of them? To solve the rough plan is, of course, get rid of the document SVG importer, replace with SVGIO, maintain the multi-page setup, do not touch the existing exporter. If anyone wants to do that, just talk to me. And the capability to create raw inverse documents is important because the old importer and opening as document always create just a raw file. But of course, for the turnaround with our SVG, we save ourselves. We should be able to reload our own created SVGs. So when you export it from Impress, it should open Impress, and you export it from it should open Raw. So as good as possible, turnarounds also means to save the page size. If you have watched before with the 5.2, I can even repeat. If you put it in just this regular, you just get a regular drawing and the object is fitted into it. So the page size is just taken from your international settings and it has nothing to do with the size of the SVG. And of course, it keeps the original data because we everywhere started to offer this just to give the users the possibility to have the original data of not only of vector graphics but also bitmap graphics in these files. You can also find them directly in our files as in the data folder. And of course, it had to be doable in a given time frame. That's always necessary. Then. So, next step, get rid of the document SVG models. Not really complicated, but you need to do it systematically. So, certain code is more task, more complicated task than you think when you start to rip well spreaded stuff out of the office. That's interesting experience to that. So I did a lot of that with AWAD, so I know some tricks to do, and let's say compiler editor is always good when you carry the definitions you stand about most of the places, but that's not enough. You also have to go down and keep the symbols of the stuff you are deleting, the in-between symbols and function calls to just check so you don't forget to delete them all. So that's logical, straightforward work, but you have to be very careful, and also to be very careful to not break anything. So keep the import filter at the moment, and do not hurt basic starting points in code, because they can be reused fantastically, because the filter keeps the filter. No point to change anything there. So replace with SVGIO based importer, also pretty straightforward at the first view. So we use import filter for different things. Create an SVG primitive. So this is the one more abstraction layer. The SVG I told library before created a sequence of primitives, and you never knew which primitive was at the top, which is good because it's not important for primitives. But now I encapsulated all of this. It's a special SVG primitive. Bless you. Whose decomposition creates the sequence of primitives you got before directly. So the reason behind this is that this is the point in memory where you can buffer the original data, of course. So then you don't have to decompose it, you can decompose it on demand. So when you load the SVG as SVG primitive, you don't have to interpret it even. You just load it as a bunch of memory, keep it. And as long as nobody asks for the decomposition, you can just stay in that state. Loading is very fast except until you drop. So, read SVG as a single SVG primitive gets a size. So, that's also interesting because with dedicated SVG primitive, you can get the B2D range from the primitive. The primitive has a standard method to get the B2D range. And if you ask this specialized SVG primitive, it can just use the already known SVG header and generate it. Still no need to decompose it. So that's nice. And based on size, next step is to create a document and maybe create a draw at first, depending on if it's all on there. So next then is insert the stereographic object to the first page, which is already there when you create a new document, you don't even need to create it. Adapt the graphic object to size and position it. Then the more important point is to adapt the page size and take the page borders into account to not corrupt them. In my first twice I ignored some page borders and got all the sites, so you have to do something clever to make them reasonable for the page size. And then that's important SVG graphic as content and the graphic object. So that's more or less the basic stuff you have to do. And at this point, the SVG is still not interpreted. That's nice because it speeds up loading, of course. So the result, let's do the same I did. It's a 5.2, it's a 6.2 to show you. So when you open this document, you see you get an adapted page and the SVG is directly centered to the page, so this is more like the original SVG file, and the original SVG is still in the way. It's a lithographic object or lithographic. So nothing lost yet, but you have a good quality SVG report, and quality is also better, not with this very simple object, but I was just using it just for demonstration. So then, when you insert it in an existing file, same as before happens, because with this order of stuff you do, you have defined the page with the page size before, and the original size of the SVG is used as needed to show it in its original. Both ways work, and both ways this time holds the original SVG. So another reason for taking SVGIO compared to the other reporter you can already see with the previews, it's just the quality of the importer. So for the 5.2, you see a lot of bad stuff, especially with the gradients, but also with the standardized stuff. So the SVGIO was just much more improved, and it was a little bit faster. And, one of the main advantages is also that you don't get raw objects, but you get primitives. With primitives, you have much higher import precision, and you can do much more with them if you want to continue to use your SVG data. So, KFLs. The question was, at that point, how to detect from the currently written SVG if it's raw or impressive, but if it was an SVG, we exported from cells and down. So, I looked at the geometry of the created SVG, and of course there are typical differences which I'm just straightforward using these nice stuff like that. So, the good thing is this leads to an abstraction and unification of the SVG filter detector, which does not only detect now that the file is the SVG file, but also is able to check if it was created in store or inference, and gives you all that information. Of course, with the two filters before, we also had two different filter detectors and stuff like that, so this can all just be merged to one, which does a good job. So, how to send the ATOIC document type? This was a bit tricky because you have to know the document type before the document is created. That's very deep in the SFX2 layer, so due to agendics and the filter detector, it's possible now. So, technically, we have now two entries for SVG types. One SVG type is SVG type created by Draw, and one is SVG type created by Inverse. And if it's not created by us, we forget to draw as the most important sort of filter. So, using the same type detector for both register type, so locally in office register type, nothing to do with operating system or stuff like that. But triggering different filters, which again then use the same implementation. Of course, it's like one of those mountain trains which comes from top two directions and makes one of this person mess again. So it's just the necessary technical stuff to get the correct document created. So, how to detect multiplication? This is a little bit more complicated because of this. But sadly, since multi-page stuff is more or less hard-coded in the DOM tree, a little bit SVG bundle 2 style similar, but not really. So, This was not as simple to detect, but in most cases it's okay to take the first 500 bytes which the filter detector does. So the filter detector can also decide this already. So you can already check normally. If it cannot yet check it, it will just need more than the first 500 bytes to decide. And six primitives, encapsulation to multi-page parts is possible. That's a really nice thing. With primitives, I don't know. I talked a lot about primitives in the last meetings, but the main point is you have this group primitive, and a group primitive decomposes to its child content, and you can just use a group primitive to type something. So there's a group primitive for age. So everything which belongs to the page, just throw it in the child context of this group, and every renderer or processor of primitives who does not know the primitive does anyways a call for the decomposition, and the decomposition is just by default returns the child context. So you can encapsulate everything anytime you have to change. No. Not a single use of primitives, they at all just work fine with that, and that's a big difference to the meta files, by the way. What I stumbled about again at that point is that we have generally a problem with the extraction of our bit and vector graphics. So everything we insert with graphics, it has this missing certain degree of freedom. So normally we should, when we continue to abstract that stuff, we should get 3-dimensional. So not only will it take for graphics, we need a third dimension to express multi-page stuff. We have that in pixel data for infinite multi-page tips, which we don't really support currently, and is not at the UI, for example, multi-page tip here. There is a timer, I'm not sure if it's still in the code which starts to switch to the next page of a multi-tip after 1 minute or something. Because the only way is the next slide of a multi-page tip. Not sure if it's still there, but since that's just a problem I want to mention where some work has to be done in the future. And even for vector performance, we have this problem now. With the SVG multi-page endpoints. So how to create multi-page? That's an interesting question because you can use this based on the SVG long tree by if you have one which contains 3 pages, you can create 3 and throw out the pages you don't need in each. So for each with 1 page you can create 1 valid SVG 1.1 then. Then they create pages in Pinterest, and on each page they put the result in one graphic object. So that would work. Or it's also possible to use this on a primitive level with the mentioned the encapsulation of single page contents. So since it's the missing part of this project, because I ran out of time, I started to use the encapsulation page primitives, so the code is there and available and ready to continue to work on it, but I have no time yet to use it. So the current import of one of our own multi-page exports is still 1 page, but at least you get the SVG encapsulated and it's 1 page, but not broken enough. So additional benefits of all that stuff is unify vector-based importers. So for this step, as I told, the SVG was already isolated, but I put this SVG primitive on top of it to even abstract it a little bit more. So why not do the same for the GI meta file GI plus? Also a vector format, we put in just the same base. So I just did that and moved the whole GI plus stuff to a library besides SVGIO, I think it's called MTFIO, so it's completely removed from ECL and the stuff and isolated behind this barrier of a known library. Right now, it's the same for GDI beta file, not with the UNO API, because some people complain about the UNO API, but it's always a question of granularity. Just one point to get the sequence of primitives part of a filter, it's no overhead at all. So why not also isolate the GI meta file stuff behind the human API with getting back the sequence of primitives instead of the old meta file stuff? So I did that too. So now the old meta file demo is also completely isolated out of the way of other stuff. So the vector-based input formats are more or less all unified, at least the most important ones. I'm sure there are different ones which we could handle the same way, but of course no reason to do that at that time. And the result is always the sequence of primitives now. So to adapt old code, which needs the internal meta file, is pretty simple. You just takes the sequence of primitives, and if it's a beta file import, if it has any beta file import using the new filter, you can just interpret the first primitive, and if it's a beta file primitive, it holds also the original beta file, so you can just extract it from there and go on with your parser. So, if needed, for payment, for example, it's not needed, the beta files are anyways, since years now, decomposed primitives and no more directly. So, then using a GI meta file primitive follows the same path as the SVG primitive. So, it's using all the same techniques. So, this leads to the state that said we could use this for any change for future gravity importers and not only for vector. So it would mean to have something isolated like that, which returns just a sequence of primitives works over the only API just as a filter, always after the original data in the background, and use a main file or whatever, it doesn't have to be manual. Decompose on demand, very important point for forms. Offer access to primitive representation, be accessible using the new API. So this isolates it from the rest of the primitives. And to make it concrete, with the new API, what you can do, so base primitive is already available for a while as X primitive. You can handle it over the new API, a single X primitive or sequence also. You can get currently already for the primitive definition for any shape, for the drawing X shape or for the whole page, for drawing X raw page. And now, additionally, you can just use X SVG parser and X EMF parser to also get a signal from primitives. So, what you can then do with them is just use X primitive to pre-render, which also existing for quite some time, to just change it to an expander. So all this taken together, you can write, you can start basically to write a converter which reads SVG and it's really different, for example. No problem. It's all there. The only thing that is not there is the detailed stuff with primitives. So currently it would not be possible to create all primitives outside of the office because the basic primitive styles you would need are not defined in the primitive. But this is just a question of if that's ever needed. Okay, so we have some time left, that's nice. So to do this acquisition support to get a real page element turnaround, just running out of time, and I hope we can use it one day. Maybe enhance and unify input formats, including bitmap data, so it would be nice to unify all of this to this state level, so maybe this would even allow better buffering, more generic buffering, and using file stream buffering or whatever. So it would all work with the same mechanism, but I think it would make things just easier. So, lots of tasks to do, personal support needed, just to mention that. And now, let's see, for example, with 6.2, it will not be too fast because I'm always using the versions with the debug page. Sorry for that. But for example, when you do a get query, don't need that. Get some space.
Basically.